Countdown, Cape Kennedy, sometime in the late 60s. An RCA computer watches 3,000 checkpoints to make sure each system is go. For men are going to the moon. The long flight demands precision, and so does the touchdown. RCA radar aboard NASA's Grumman-built lunar landing craft provides pinpoint navigation. Precise RCA controls direct both engine and guidance for a smooth landing. Leaving the spacecraft, an American astronaut walks on the moon and transmits through communications links provided by RCA a new world of information to NASA scientists on Earth. Earth, where today similar skills give RCA Victor Color TV space age dependability. Come into the space age with RCA, the most trusted name in electronics.
Speaking as a bird, and a high-performance model at that, I have to confess my open admiration for the ingenuity of man in his conquest of the skies. All the more so when you consider that there's scarcely a creature less suited by natural evolution to flight. Heavy bones, weak muscles, no feathers. But that's just where his ingenuity has already put him far ahead of us in just 60 years. Not being born a flying creature, he had to change his geometry, so to speak, in order to get himself off the ground. And that turned out to be the key. He's been going faster and faster ever since. Let me show you what I mean. You remember the early airplanes. Our friend had built himself a body to ride in, an engine to move it, and wings to carry it aloft. Then when he got up here with us, he started learning about some of the laws of flight. Drag, for instance. That set of wheels worked fine for landing or taking off. But up in the air, it just wasn't streamlined. It acted something like a sail in the wind, kept his airplane from going as fast as he would have liked. And just using more engine power wasn't a very satisfactory answer. That simply burned more fuel. And if there's one thing man is, it's dollar conscious. In fact, he wouldn't be going as fast as he is today if he couldn't make a profit out of speed. Well, it occurred to him that changing the geometry might be the answer. So he tried a retractable gear on his airplane, and that did it. After he lifted off and wanted his best speed, he just folded the gear inside out of the airstream, and no more drag. Faster speed, lower cost. Ingenuity. You see what I mean? And it didn't stop there. That windmill on his engine was the next obstacle to going faster. The propeller blades needed a shallow pitch when the airplane was going slowly, landing or taking off. But at higher speeds, that flat surface just wasn't aerodynamically or economically efficient. Another application of ingenuity, controlling the geometry again, produced the variable pitch propeller. By making the pitch of the blade steeper as his airspeed increased, man managed to get still more speed out of his machine without paying more for it. One of his biggest breakthroughs came when he tackled the problem of his wings themselves. You see, he knew that it took a rather good-sized wing to generate enough lift to overcome the weight of the airplane and get it off the ground at a safe speed, say 60 miles an hour, and in a reasonable runway distance. But again, once he was airborne, he didn't need all that wing for lift. A wing half the size would do. The little wing would be lighter, so the engine could move it along without burning up as much fuel. And being smaller, it would create less drag, permitting the airplane to go faster. However, this arrangement, so efficient for high-speed cruising, would have some drawbacks. Having less lift, it would land at 100 miles an hour, dangerously fast in those days, and it would need quite a lot of runway. Two design goals seemed incompatible. Man could build a fast, economical, small wing airplane to attract passengers and their fares, Or he could build a slow, heavy, big-wing airplane to lift them off and land them safely and practically, but not both. Well, of course, you know that compromise just wasn't part of man's nature. He thought the problem through and came up with a new way of varying the geometry of his small, high-speed wing with the flap. By extending this movable section, he could increase the wing area and the lift and the drag for slower, shorter landings and takeoffs. And then, by tucking the flap back out of the way, he could still cover the money-making miles between airports at top speed. It was becoming apparent to our featherless friend that variable geometry was probably going to be the important principle in any future improvements he wanted to make in the performance of his airplanes. And his need for speed was growing all the time. Well, he was right. The modern jetliners of today carry paying passengers from place to place at 600 miles an hour. And their wings are swept now instead of straight. More efficient shape for near sonic speed. But they still have to land at a safe, slow speed and on a normal runway. And variable geometry makes it possible. When you think about it, it's really the only answer. You can't make a fast airplane design do a slow job safely. And you can't make a slow one fly fast economically. You have to design your airplane to do both jobs. So you have to be able to change its geometry for the job at hand. This is more important to man today than ever. A couple of years ago, the leaders of the country where I live decided the time had come to have SSTs, supersonic transport airplanes, crisscrossing the Earth at up to three times the speed of sound, stimulating air travel, commerce, recreation, international relations. The nation wrote a tough set of goals for this supersonic transport, but they were sensible ones. Naturally, it would have to be as fast as or faster than any other nation's SST. Then it would have to be profitable for the airlines to operate. But at the same time, it must be as safe as the safest airplanes flying today, and it must be able to use today's airports under today's air traffic regulations. And, of course, it must be a good citizen from the noise standpoint. So, you see, man was up against the same design challenge he'd always faced when he wanted more speed without sacrificing safety and economy to get it. But this time, the challenge was greatly magnified and more complicated. The airplane would have to spend most of its time cruising at around 1,800 miles an hour. Then it would have to spend some of its time at subsonic speeds, climbing or descending or holding in traffic patterns or flying very short route segments. And of course, it would have to land normally at a speed down around 140 miles an hour, just like today's jetliners. And that's quite a spread in performance for one airplane. This one would have to fly both slow and fast and triple fast as well. The airplane builders had already been working on this very problem. Now they redoubled their efforts. They'd found that an extremely swept back wing, offering as little resistance to the airstream as possible, was needed to efficiently reach cruising speeds near Mach 3. But for subsonic speeds, and particularly during takeoff and landing, a lot more wing area and span were needed to give the airplane enough lift and safe handling qualities, and even then, the landing attitude would be pretty extreme. Well, making this high-speed wing big enough to do the slower jobs turned out to compromise the fast job. At supersonic speeds, the big wing was heavier and created more drag. And thrusting this heavier weight forward against this higher drag called for bigger engines, which would burn more fuel and make more noise. And then the bigger engines and extra fuel and structure to carry it would add still more weight. And this would mean, but I'm sure you see the problem. It was the old dilemma all over again. And compromising the airplane design was just as hard a solution for man to accept as before. One of the airplane builders, a firm named Boeing, wouldn't compromise. Instead, they tried a different approach. First, they studied high-speed wing shapes to find out which one would be the best for flying 2 to 3 times the speed of sound. They studied better than 60 different wings, spent more than 13,000 hours in wind tunnels doing it. And they found that an arrow-shaped wing was the most aerodynamically efficient planform in that speed range. Next, they sized the arrow wing for supersonic flight and matched the fuselage. That took care of the high-speed cruising requirement. But how would an SST with a small wing swept back more than 70 degrees perform at subsonic speeds or way down at landing speeds? Those jobs clearly called for a different sort of wing geometry. And that was what the Boeing designers provided their SST with, a variable sweep wing. For landing, this SST can change its geometry, sweep its wings all the way forward on big, sturdy, simple pivots to an angle of about 20 degrees. And this change of aerodynamic surfaces permits it to land in a normal runway length, in a normal attitude, with good stability and control, and just as safely and slowly as one of today's jetliners. The same is true of the takeoff. Safe, slow, and compatible with the airports and air traffic control procedures that we have right now. After lifting off, the variable sweep SST can change its wing geometry for the next job. Bringing the flaps up and partially sweeping the wings back gives the airplane the right shape and lift and drag characteristics to climb out fast, with less community noise and on less fuel, too. Then for subsonic cruising, the pilot can sweep the wings back further to just the right angle to match the desired speed. And of course, in supersonic cruise with the wings fully back, the variable sweep SST offers less frontal area, generates less drag, uses less fuel, and therefore carries more passengers and makes more money. The changing geometry of flight. Man's logic is beautiful in its simplicity, isn't it? The right geometry for supersonic speed, the right geometry for subsonic speed, and the right geometry for taking off into the skies or settling slowly to Earth. And the result is a supersonic transport design that's the superior or the equal of the best jetliners flying today in every respect. Speed, safety, passenger appeal, compatible operation, and earning power. Changing geometry to write a new chapter in aviation history. Of course, the final proof of this one, too, is in the flying. But Boeing airplanes have a habit of coming up to or even bettering their design goals of performance, safety, and economics. Why am I so interested? Well, if the SST is going to be flying my colors, I want it to be the best. After all, it's a matter of national significance.